This is Mr. Hasdovic's World History Online Lecture Series, Lecture Number 9, The Road to World War II. Although nobody knew it for certain at the time, the moment the last bullets flew during the First World War in November of 1918, events were unfolding that would make a Second World War inevitable. The lessons the world, and the West, specifically Europe and the United States, chose to learn from the First World War would prove insufficient to stop the momentum from building toward a second global showdown. Furthermore, the lessons the West refused to learn from the First World War would all but seal the world's fate some 20 years later, when in September of 1939, the single bloodiest event in human history would unfold and expand. World War II would involve more than 100 nations from around the world in a struggle that would determine once and for all what political and economic systems would dominate around the world. And the war's results would further profoundly influence societies and cultures around the globe for decades afterwards. More than 55 million lives would be lost in World War II, the majority of them non-combatant civilians. World War II would usher in technology of death previously unimagined, as millions would die in the industrialized gas chambers of Nazi-dominated Europe. The Blitzkrieg would unleash a hail of death from seemingly all directions as the Nazis used modern technology to conquer and slaughter faster than before, ending the era of trench warfare. And more than 150,000 lives would be vaporized in an instant as atomic weaponry would be introduced at the war's conclusion. As we've already learned in class, the aggressor nations, specifically Japan and Germany, had been preparing for this bloody showdown for years prior to the official start of World War II. Japan had been building and expanding its empire since 1895, using warfare and unrestricted violence upon non-combatant civilians in order to spread its imperial power. In the late 1920s, Hitler was able to resurrect a crippled, demoralized, and bankrupt Germany by combining the Italian political philosophy of fascism with a fanatical, maniacal hatred for the Versailles Treaty that ended World War I, and an institutionalized governmental policy of racism, wherein anyone who was not a member of the Aryan race was fit only for conquest, or worse. Nationalism, militarism, and an imperialistic desire to spread their empires were alive and well in both Japan and Germany, as well as Italy. The same ingredients that fueled World War I. But these qualities were notably absent in the former Entente nations of England, France, and the United States, who were all gripped by the paralysis of the Great Depression well into the late 1930s. Further, prior to World War II, Japan, Italy, and Germany formed the Axis Alliance. As far as these powers were concerned, all the necessary ingredients were in place to begin a new wave of warfare and a new wave of conquest. Let's take a look at the step-by-step process that unleashed the single most significant event in modern history. We learned in class how Hitler and the Nazis, who were initially unpopular and unwelcome in Germany through much of the 1920s, were able to combine German resentment about the terms of the Versailles Treaty, such as the War Guilt Clause and the $35 billion of debt imposed upon Germany, with Europeans' fears of the spread of communism, and then turn those factors into political victories. Once Hitler was democratically elected to power, he and the Nazis made political moves to seal their complete control of Germany's government. Their first acts were to institute the values and mores of fascism. Hitler banned all political parties in Germany, except of course for the Nazi Party. He made communism illegal, and all known socialist and communist party members became the first prisoners of what would develop into Hitler's highly elaborate and highly organized system of concentration camps. Hitler next outlawed all labor union. In a fascist society, the needs and wants of the state, that is, the national government, are the only needs and wants that should exist. Labor unions, which fought for the rights and improved working conditions for factory workers, were incompatible with the philosophy of fascism. Hitler likened unions to communism, and in so doing, made them first unpopular and second illegal. Again, known union leaders and agitators were imprisoned and ultimately killed. One of the things that made Hitler initially quite popular in Germany, and even around the world, was how quickly he eliminated unemployment. Since the government, hence the Nazis, were now completely in charge of German society, Hitler employed all of those men whom the Depression had initially rendered unemployed. He had these millions of men work on enormous state projects, such as building thousands of miles of some of the finest roads that existed in the world. The Autobahn came out of this project. Interestingly enough, many of these roads ended right at the borders of Belgium, France, and Poland. Workers built barracks, airfields, and labored in transforming factories into places that would build some of the most modern engines and vehicles that ever existed. Hitler recruited thousands of men into Germany's blossoming air force. Now, under the terms of the Versailles Treaty, Germany couldn't technically have a military, so its air force initially began as part of Germany's postal system. Every day, thousands of planes that looked suspiciously like fighters and bombers took off from Germany's airfields and delivered mail around the country, giving Germany the fastest, most efficient form of mail delivery service in the world at the time, all the while training tens of thousands of pilots to perform the same kind of maneuvers they would eventually use to attack their neighboring nations. Every morning before workers went out to build roads and other construction projects, they practiced marching in formation and performing pretty obvious military practice maneuvers. Only instead of rifles, they carried pickaxes and shovels. Germany's schools were transformed into indoctrination centers in which Nazi ideology was pounded into the minds of German schoolchildren. Much like Japan at this time, German students were taught that service to the nation, especially in making the armed forces stronger, was the highest calling any German could have. Hitler also worked to court international allies, first regionally. Since fascism was actually the brainchild of Italy's Benito Mussolini, Hitler was quick to forge a tight bond with Italy. He also found ready allies in the Eastern European nations of Hungary, Romania, and Bulgaria. Spain was currently experiencing a civil war by the time the Nazis were firmly in power, and in 1935, Hitler threw his support behind the Spanish fascists, who were duking it out with Spanish communists for control over the Iberian Peninsula. By 1935, Hitler had firm control of all aspects of German life, and his propaganda machine, administered by the ruthlessly brilliant Joseph Goebbels, was quickly shoring up even greater support for Hitler around Central Europe. Most Germans were convinced, or at least scared into being convinced, that Hitler was Germany's savior, and in 1935, he was ready to test the waters for his future plans. And Spain would be the swimming pool into which Hitler would dip his feet. As I mentioned earlier, in 1935, Spain was in the grips of a civil war, not too different from what Germany, France, and most of Europe had experienced once the Great Depression set in by 1929. Fascist supporters were violently clashing with communist forces for control over the nations who had given up and turned their backs upon democracy and capitalism during the Great Depression. In Spain, Francisco Franco led the Spanish fascist troops. However, the Spanish communists had been putting up stiff resistance. At this point, Hitler decided to enter the contest. Not yet strong enough to outright violate the Versailles Treaty and repel the intervention that would probably come from England and France and maybe even the United States, Hitler could not send his people to fight directly in Spain's civil war. Instead, he gave Francisco Franco and the fascists the tanks, airplanes, and artillery that they needed in order to tip the balance against the Spanish communists. In exchange, Franco let Hitler and his military advisors direct Spain's use of Germany's equipment. It was in 1936 Spain that Hitler first tested out his concept of the Blitzkrieg, or lightning war, using some of the fastest and most powerful aircraft in the world to first bomb a target city, at the same time his powerful artillery was hammering at it from miles away. The Blitzkrieg then ordered in rapid troop deployment from the fastest trucks, tanks, and troop carriers ever developed in order to invade and control the target city once the artillery and aircraft bombardments had ceased. This tactic worked even better than Hitler hoped. entire towns, villages, and cities, which were controlled firmly by the Spanish communists, were either overrun by the fascists in just a few days, or even a few hours, or were completely blown off the map. The Blitzkrieg worked, Franco and the Spanish fascists won Spain and would remain in power until 1975, and Hitler grinned and schemed. With the sweeping success of his Blitzkrieg in Spain, Hitler was ready to begin his moves toward a conquest of Europe itself. His first step began shortly before the fascist conquest of Spain was complete. On March 7th of 1936, Hitler armed those who had been his construction crew and turned them into his army. He then sent them into the part of Germany that bordered France, known as the Rhineland. Under the provisions of the Versailles Treaty, this was a blatantly illegal move and a call for immediate armed intervention by, at least, Belgium and France. Europe was mortified at this move. However, because the Great Depression had so crippled the economies of England and France, and those nations' people wanted their governments to solve their own domestic concerns before intervening in foreign affairs, those nations largely did nothing. They were really unable to do much. England agreed to allow Germany the right to violate those parts of the Versailles Treaty, specifically Articles 42, 43, and 44, by rearming the Rhineland in exchange for a promise by Hitler to not use any armed force to expand Germany's borders. In other words, England and France let Germany blatantly violate the terms of the World War I treaty imposed, which would ultimately make Germany much stronger by creating a defensive perimeter right next to France, solely in exchange for not using its newfound strength to acquire more territory. Of course Hitler promised that his interests in expansion were over, and of course he was going to quickly break that promise. In March of 1938, Hitler proclaimed a desire to annex Austria to Germany under the pretenses that Austria was heavily dominated by the German language, culture, and people. Hitler basically stated that much of Austria is already German, so therefore it only makes sense to unite these disenfranchised Germans with their homeland. To give the appearance of fairness and respect for the wishes of democratic England and France, Hitler even held an election in Austria. Did the Austrians favor being annexed to Germany? Astonishingly, more than 99% of Austrians voted in favor of this act. Of course the Nazis had infiltrated and manipulated Austria in this election. It was a fraud, but Hitler had what he wanted. An entire nation added on to his own without the use of violence. Even with the use of a supposedly democratic means to acquire it. Because of this, it would be hypocritical for the now terrified England and France to cry foul. Hitler even met with the leaders of France and England in Munich, Germany, to sign an agreement that would allow his military to occupy the newly annexed Austria in exchange for no more territorial expansion. And again, of course, Hitler agreed to this at the same time he was planning to expand his territory even further. England and France were sold on Hitler's lies, however. England's Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain famously proclaimed after the Munich Agreement that with Hitler's cooperation, England and France had secured, quote, peace in our time. World War II would begin in less than 2 years from the moment he uttered those words. In March of 1939, Hitler used the excuse of a desire for Lebensraum, which is the German word for living space, as a need to annex the Sudetenland, which was territory that made up much of Western Czechoslovakia, which shared a border with Germany, just to its east. Again, Hitler professed in this particular territory there were a lot of Germans, and therefore it was only natural that the territory should unite them with the fatherland. At this violation of the Munich Agreement, which Hitler had signed less than a year earlier, England and France had threatened to go to war. They were not mobilized and not prepared for a fight. And because Germany didn't actually use any violent military means to expand its territory, citizens in Britain and France weren't sufficiently terrified to actually make their governments take a more aggressive stance against Germany. In just 3 years, Hitler had added Austria and much of Czechoslovakia to Germany, while also putting his new standing army, which was illegal, in each nation's borders, as well as into the Rhineland, right next to France, without firing so much as a bullet. The biggest shock, however, was yet to come. From the moment he had fantasized about a Germany under Nazi and his rule, Hitler wanted to go to war against Germany's foes from World War I. As a veteran from that war, he was embittered not simply by the Versailles Treaty, but by Germany's surrender to nations that he saw as inferior. He used lies, deception, fraudulent elections, and the fact that his foes were economically crippled and preoccupied during the 1930s to his advantage by expanding Germany's territory without having to fight for so much as an inch of it. He also knew that if Germany was going to conquer England and France, it could not be distracted by its former foe to the east, Russia. The two-front war it fought during the First World War was ultimately responsible for denying Germany a swift victory in that contest, and Hitler would not repeat that mistake. So in August of 1939, Hitler met with the USSR's premier, Joseph Stalin. Despite the fact that fascists and communists were political opposites and therefore bitter foes, both men exchanged pleasantries. Hitler took advantage of the anger Stalin felt toward the way Russia was treated first at the Versailles Treaty, when it wasn't invited and lost all of the land that Germany had conquered, if you remember. And then with the Russian Revolution, in which England and France and the United States intervened to try to keep the communist Bolsheviks from succeeding in their revolution. Stalin had refused to sign any treaties with England or France, and instead turned a friendly ear to Hitler's proposal, which was really quite simple. In exchange for agreeing not to fight one another, Hitler told Stalin of his soon-to-hatch plan to invade and conquer Poland. If the USSR would stay out of the fight, Hitler would give Stalin half of Poland and all of its industrial resources for free. Stalin just had to agree to not attack the Nazis. Now, if anyone knew of a deal that was too good to be true, it was Stalin. But since the Nazis were already so well prepared for war, so technologically superior, and so aggressive, Stalin realized that the USSR, which only 10 years ago first began constructing its industrial center of Magnitogorsk, was in no shape to fight Hitler. Stalin knew that Hitler would turn his back on their agreement the moment its advantages were spent, but this non-aggression pact would give Stalin time to build up his army and his defenses. He signed Hitler's non-aggression pact, an action that had all but signed, sealed, and delivered the doom of Poland and Eastern Europe, and would soon deliver France and Belgium into Hitler's hands without the distraction of fighting a war to the east. The West was outraged and felt betrayed by the USSR. But really, they had no one to blame but themselves. England, France, and the United States had spent the better part of the 1920s spreading fear and paranoia about communism and the Soviet Union. They had lent troops, weapons, and money to try to suppress the communist revolution. They refused to recognize the USSR at the Versailles Treaty and gave them no aid, no reparations, nor the land it had lost after Russia's devastating surrender in the First World War. Stalin had good reason to distrust and turn his back on the West, as well as good reason to fear Hitler and buy time to prepare for what would be Hitler's ultimate betrayal. Unfortunately, Stalin's decision, good perhaps in the short run, would prove nearly devastating and very costly in the long run. With all his chess pieces in place, Hitler prepared for the move that would start World War II. He had troops and equipment on the borders of France and Belgium. Central Europe was firmly under his control. The USSR would pose no threat from the east, leaving nations in between Germany and Russia easy pickings for Hitler's blitzkrieg. To Hitler, the time was right to push over the first domino that would lead to a conquered Europe, and that domino was Poland. On September 1st of 1939, Hitler sent his blitzkrieg on an immediate and destructive rampage into Poland. England and France immediately declared war upon Germany, finally finding the strength of character and purpose to stand up to and not succumb to Hitler's pressure. The militaries, however, were not sufficiently strong enough nor mobilized to pose an immediate threat to Germany, especially with winter coming on. 2 weeks later, by September 17th of 1939, Hitler's Blitzkrieg had all but crushed eastern Poland and its capital in Warsaw, giving Hitler access to the seas in northern Europe and Poland's tremendous production power. By the end of the month, Poland was conquered. Then the winter of 1939 hit. The freezing cold of northern and central Europe's winters still played a decisive role in military strategy, even as late as 1939. Since antifreeze really didn't exist, not only was Hitler's Blitzkrieg frozen in its tracks, but so were the armies and equipment of England and France. With Poland conquered, and all of Germany's troops sitting on the border of Belgium, who once again declared its neutrality in this fight, hoping that this time Germany would respect it, as well as France, both sides were merely waiting for the spring thaw to start up the fight. This wintertime pause in the early stages of World War II brought a lot of speculation that there wouldn't be much of a fight. Germany's Blitzkrieg was derisively referred to in the West as the Sitzkrieg, since it was immobilized by the cold. World War II is referred to by the Western press as the phony war, the war that never really started. And while this ironic beginning to the most bloody conflict in human history did bring a temporary sigh of relief, it was only a pause. While the snows fell, the Blitzkrieg waited. Hitler knew that with the thaw, little would stand in the way of his army and his air force. And little did. Once the spring arrived, Hitler went on the move faster than anyone could have imagined. Within just a matter of a few weeks, Hitler conquered Belgium and the Netherlands. France, who thought it safe behind its massive fortifications on the Maginot Line, would fall to the Nazis in only a month. By late June of 1940, Hitler did what Germany could not do in 4 years of combat during World War I, and that is conquer all of Western Europe. Only England, separated by a mere 20 miles of the English Channel, stood in his way of a complete conquest of all of Europe. And with the Americans declaring neutrality yet again, England's fall seemed all but inevitable. Now, as we learned in class, Japan had spent much of the late 1800s and the first 30 years of the 1900s violently expanding its empire. In the 1930s, it was ready to use its empire's geographic advantage to invade China's mainland. In 1931, nearly 2 years before even the Nazis came to power in Germany, Japan attacked, using a faked bombing of one of its trains by supposed Chinese terrorists as an excuse. Japan invaded China's coastal cities and swiftly crushed them all. Perhaps its most infamous conquest was in the city of Nanking. During 1937 and 1938, Japan brutally slaughtered nearly 400,000 of the city's civilian inhabitants. Its army imprisoned tens of thousands of Chinese females, from girls younger than 4 years old to its oldest women. And the members of the Japanese army subsequently raped these thousands of women to death. Bent upon its own policy of racial superiority, Japan butchered the city's remaining infant and child population in what would become infamously known as the Rape of Nanking. Despite the fact that Japan had initiated such brutal and violent acts against a nation in which the Europeans and the United States had colonies, the West did nothing to stop them, aside from placing trade restrictions on the Japanese Empire. No longer would the West give the Japanese the oil and steel its army depended upon for strength, but the size of its empire now meant that Japan didn't need the West's trade nearly as much as it once did. The League of Nations, which was at one time the world's hope for eternal peace, found that it couldn't discipline the Japanese Empire. Since Japan was a part of the League of Nations and would never vote against its own actions, the League of Nations could never muster the unanimous vote needed to intervene and bring Japan to bear. Ultimately, Japan decided to quit its membership all the way back in 1931, the year it first began its aggressive conquest of Asia and the Pacific nations, thus showing that the League of Nations was nothing but a hollow promise, an ineffective means to end war. We're in the By the end of the 1930s, Japan was poised to push the West out of the Pacific entirely, to take the colonies in Indonesia and Indochina that the French, British, and Belgians had, to push the U.S. out of its Pacific holdings in the Philippines, the islands of Guam, Midway, and the Marshall Islands, even out of Hawaii. It set its sights on conquest in India and Australia, even the Pacific coast of the United States. In 1939, Japan began preparations and practice for what would become the single largest, most devastating sneak attack in history. At the same time, it was professing friendship and loyalty to its European and American colonial neighbors. When Japan officially joined in the Axis alliance with Nazi Germany and Mussolini's Italy in September of 1940, World War II was already a year old. But the U.S. was not involved. Many wondered if Japan's allegiance to Axis aggression wasn't enough to bring the Americans into the fight, just what would it take? The United States and the rest of the world would soon find out. And on December 7th, 1941, the Asian and European conflict would truly become the Second World War. You can tell him that you're working at the factory, but compared to him, you live a life of ease.